being invited here, and I'd like to get to know you briefly before I tell you a whole lot about myself or launch into my prepared talks. And in particular, I'd like to know these things from you. We'll take a moment, maybe write down your answers. I'll go around the room and poll you. Your name, hopefully you already know that. Your interest in blockchain in three words. Boil it down to a three-word statement that is your interest in blockchain, technology, whatever it is. And what you want from me tonight in five words or less. Could even be one word.
That's challenging.
Well, anyone can talk for 5 minutes. If you bring it down to three or five words, that is a challenge. But of course, we have a tragedy in the commons. We have a limited amount of time and space. So I'm pushing it on to you to boil your thoughts down and be concise. Take a minute. Serious folks are writing theirs. Didn't think I'd put you to work, did you? Texting their grandma. Never mind. So I'll start here, work my way back, and then up the front. Go.
I'm Sean Ballard.
Sean Ballard.
Yes. And for the blockchain, three words: global financial freedom. And I want to learn how to decentralize everything.
Okay.
Leon, my three words is building future wealth. Five words is how EOS plans to scale.
Very nice.
I'm Richard. My three words are change the world. And my five words for you are EOS competitive advantages and challenges.
You take it in this format well. I love it.
Hey, my name is Sharad. My three words are also global financial freedom. Five words, a cohesive understanding of EOS.
My name is Michael. The three words are freedom, business, and innovation. The five words are educational talk, relevant, concise, interesting.
The bar is rising slowly here.
Bruce Belwakwa said three words would be community, transparency, and adoption. And five words, governance, got one.
Okay, so we have four extra words if anyone runs long.
My name is Jay, and my interest would be freedom, optimization, and governance. And what I want to learn tonight would be EOS versus Ethereum.
Nice. Okay. So now I have six words. Net positive six. Good job.
Hey, my name is Mayur, and I would also say global financial freedom. And I'd probably want to know more about how EOS does parallel processing.
That's cool. I think it's
how many of us does parallel processing?
Five. Cool.
So we're still net six. Next six. In the back.
I would go with global financial freedom, I guess. I know that's been the name to hear, but there's so many things I could say, I would like to say. But and my five words, anything you have on EOS.
I'm Craig Murray. Three words. Interest, EOS block producer. And what do we want from tonight? It's like a haiku here. Learn more about EOS governance.
That's six words.
Is it?
Learn more. EOS governance.
Five.
And so plus he had the six to draw on, right? We got the six in reserve.
That's right.
So we're still running it.
One arbitration already.
Still in the black.
Yeah, my name is Burbus Katz. Three words would be forge in the future. I'm with EOS Blocksmith. And I have to agree with everybody else, financial world and independence.
Outstanding. Good to have you.
My name is Raul. Awesome dApp development. Don't expect to learn that here today, but that's. And also into governance and infrastructure. Yes.
Okay. Can you skip me?
I'm totally skipping you. Yes.
My name is Richard Finn. Three words are future, technology, investment. And then tonight, understand structure, EOS versus others.
Excellent. My name is Anna. My interest in blockchain, three words, would be efficient future freedom. And then what I want to learn tonight, five words, greater understanding of initiating change.
Very nice. The room finishes up six. I got to say, that's fabulous. Plus, you got to notice how we're really on the same page here. This is going to be an interesting time. All right, I'm Thomas Cox. I am a blockchain governance expert. I will not be mentioning my employer's name because I'm not here on behalf of my employer. My employer has decided to do zero marketing in the United States, and I've been informed that if I do anything that looks vaguely like marketing, I'm in trouble or maybe fired. So I'm literally here on my own time and my own dime. I work an eight-hour day after I fly in, and then in the evening I get to do a talk. And the payoff to me is getting to know you and getting feedback on my governance model, because I'm actively developing the governance model of EOS, and I don't get the same look of like, huh? That I need to get when people are confused, or the, oh, I get it now, when people really get it. If you ever want to get in touch with me, this is my name, this is my personal email address, EUDAE, that's short for eudaimonism, the philosophy of human thriving, and that's my cell phone number. Please don't abuse it. Right, so what does EOS bring to the blockchain? Before I get into the governance, let's just talk blockchains in general. A lot of you probably know that EOS is a faster, smarter, better blockchain, we believe. And in particular, it has things like half-second block time. And when the Byzantine fault-tolerant piece is added in the next few weeks, we'll have 1 second finality, as opposed to the 15-second blocks and a couple minutes finality for Ethereum, 10-minute blocks and 45-minute finality for Bitcoin. We use delegated proof of stake, a greener and more decentralized approach to consensus. And we are currently running over 1,000 transactions per second, single threaded, and we expect to have that be our performance at launch at 10 p.m. on June 2nd. That's 10 p.m. Universal Coordinated Time, which would be 5 p.m. here. 5 p.m. here in the Central Time. It's a Saturday, and I'll be in Blacksburg at our headquarters watching the live stream and biting my nails. Human friendly, we have account names rather than just public keys, so you actually have a name you might remember. We also have the ability to recover lost keys, recover from hacked and stolen accounts. And we're very developer friendly. Things like declarative security and self-describing interfaces. Our goal in creating this was to make it as developer-friendly and user-friendly as possible because of the experiences we've all seen in other blockchains who have gone before us and have learned so many incredibly important and, in many cases, painful lessons. It's the advantage of being the second mover. They say the early bird gets the worm, but the second mouse gets the cheese. That might be the case here. And by the way, no transaction fees. A very important thing, if you're a dApp developer, you don't want to be in the position of dinging people for a penny here and a quarter of a penny there every time they get like on a Facebook post or do any other interactions with your application. So what's the promise of public blockchains in general? Well, it's decentralization. It's the ability to empower individuals and small groups over the big players, put them on a level playing field, maybe even give an advantage to the small players, to have an ease of entry to new competition, and to better serve customers. What's the downside of public blockchains? It's decentralization. In particular, there's nobody in charge, and therefore crooks can just go wild, and we've seen that. Up until now, the code is the law. That was the mantra of Ethereum, among others. Whatever happens is what was supposed to happen. And if you didn't like it, you should have looked at the code yourself. Which, for a certain kind of person, makes sense, but not for your grandma, and maybe not even for you. I can't read Solidity, so that's not very comforting to me. In less than a decade, hackers have stolen $1.2 billion worth of Bitcoin and Ether, and that was in February, so now it's April, so it's probably 1.6 by now. It's wacky. Here's just an example. Cryptocurrency thefts, a little list here of the big ones from June of 2011 just through August of last year, and then the plunder of $500 million worth of NIM. And then my all-time favorite so far, not that this is a challenge, is the $300 million lost accidentally. User mistakenly takes control of hundreds of wallets containing cryptocurrency Ether, destroying them in a panic while trying to give them back.
How do you give them accidentally?
They left a bug in the parody wallet code, and he tripped the bug.
Oh.
And he's like, oh, I didn't mean to do that.
And he actually executed the destroy command, I think.
Yeah. Here's the actual dialogue. I was relating the story. It's like
you are
sending
this now.
Kill, destroy to random contracts.
Break this space.
So, which tells us that the unit testing by the parity wallet developers was perhaps less than robust. And
I know, right?
You are famous now.
Like, will I get arrested for that? It's like, are you the one that called the kill transaction? Who left that turned on? So what's maddening to me is the $300 million worth of Ether, which might be worth even more now, is just, it's out there in its destroyed form, and there have been some movements like, we could like put in a special transaction and get it back. And they're like, no, we can't do that because the code is the law. Can you imagine explaining that to your customer? Saying, hey, you know, we lost $1 million of your stuff because, you know, the code is the law and there was this bug and I'm sorry. Really? This is not ready for prime time. This is not working. This is not an environment for business. The only big players today in these public blockchains so far are speculators playing a zero-sum game. If you buy low, sell high, some other idiot is buying high from you. It's zero-sum. Or miners who create coins but not value. Now, some folks understand that intuitively and some don't. Let me pause and explain that one. How many of you remember in history reading about the Spanish Empire? And they took over, right? They took over South America and Central America. And they were bringing gold and jewels and they were rich and it was amazing. And they were enslaving people and it was like, they were like running rampant. They were the most powerful nation in Europe because of all the gold they were getting from the New World. You turn the chapter, and England is in charge. I'm like, what just happened?
Inflation.
They didn't bring back goods and services to enrich the population of Spain. They brought back money. It went into the government's pockets. Now, they could buy more stuff, but the number of mules, the number of bushels of corn in Spain was totally unchanged. There was just more gold chasing it. Now, if you're not in government and you're in Spain, your prices all just went up. It was pre-printing press inflation. And it destroyed their economy. It wasn't the Spanish Armada that knocked the empire down. Poor England was stuck with the northern part of America, and all they could bring back were raw materials to turn into goods and services, to enrich the nation and create wealth. Oh, no wonder they were running things by the next chapter in your history book. But right now, the miners are running things. What are they making? They're making coins. Ooh, yay. What a great service. And the miners are also securing the blockchain, which is a huge service, and they're doing it for money. But what's being created? Well, and then there, by the way, there's the crooks with the negative sum game. So there's no real disincentives to bad behavior, and there's no real apps, no real commerce, and no real value being created in these platforms. There's Dogecoin, a joke that's worth $500 million. But what do you do with it? Speculate. There's no commerce here. So why are there no disincentives? Why this wacky behavior? Well, human behavior on technology platforms are controlled by four different types of constraints, according to Lawrence Lessig and his New Chicago School model.